some of the prisoners were actual German POWs brought to Camp Ritchie, so the Ritchie boys could practice their interrogation techniques.
I understand you had sparring partners. You play acted.
One had to play act with some of the people were acting as prisoners, and some of them were real prisoners.
By the spring of 1944, the Ritchie boys were ready to return to Western Europe, this time as naturalized Americans in American uniforms. Still, if they were captured, they knew what the Nazis would do to them. Some of them requested new dog tags, with very good reason.
This dog tag says Hebrew. Did your dog tag identify you as Jewish?
I preferred not having it. I asked them to leave it off.
You didn't want to be identified as Jewish going back to Western Europe?
No, because I knew that the contact with Germans might not be very nice.
On June 6, 1944, D-Day, the Allies launched one of the most sweeping military operations in history. A mighty onslaught of more than 160,000 men, 13,000 aircraft, and 5,000 vessels.
We were on a PT boat taking off from Southampton, and we all were scared. We were briefed that the Germans were not going to welcome us greatly. As a Jew, I knew I might not be treated exactly by the Geneva rules.
Divided into six-man teams, the Ritchie boys were attached to different army units. Their job? To provide battlefield intelligence. When they landed on the beaches of Normandy, Wehrmacht troops were waiting for them, well-armed and well-prepared. Victor Brombert was with the 1st American Armored Division to land on Omaha Beach. He is still haunted by what he experienced that day.
I saw immense debris, wounded people, dead people. I remember being up on the cliff the first night over Omaha Beach, and we were strafed. And I said to myself, now it's the end, because I could feel the machine gun bullets.
Is that when you first realize I'm in a war here?
Yes, I realized that I was afraid. I never calculated that there is such a thing as terror, fear. So I experienced viscerally fear.
On the front lines from Normandy onwards, the Ritchie boys fought in every major battle in Europe, collecting tactical intelligence, interrogating prisoners and civilians, all in service of winning the war. When we come back, we'll hear about some of the surprising ways they forged connections with the enemy in order to extract strategic information. In 1944, the Ritchie boys headed to Europe to fight in a war that was for them intensely personal. They were members of a secret group whose mastery of the German language and culture helped them provide battlefield intelligence that proved pivotal to the Allies' victory. The Ritchie boys landed on the beaches of Normandy on D-Day and helped liberate Paris. They crossed into Germany with the Allied armies and witnessed the horrors of the Nazi concentration camps. All the while, they tracked down evidence and interrogated Nazi criminals later tried at Nuremberg. It was also in Europe that some of them, like Guy Stern, learned what had happened to the families they left behind.
This is it. They're on the beach.
By the summer of 1944, German troops in Normandy were outnumbered and overpowered. The Allies liberated Paris in August.
The date was August 25th.
And drove Nazi troops out of France. But Hitler was determined to continue the war. In the Ardennes region of Belgium, the Germans mounted a massive counteroffensive, which became known as the Battle of the Bulge.
I see a tent in the background of that photo right in front of you.
Yes, that's my interrogation tent.
So this is you on the job. You're
yes,
in Belgium?
Doing my job interrogating, right.
Amid the chaos of war, Guy Stern and the other Ritchie boys had a job to do. Embedded in every army unit, they interrogated tens of thousands of captured Nazi soldiers, as well as civilians, extracting key strategic information on enemy strength, troop movements, and defensive positions. They then typed up their daily reports in the field to be passed up the chain of command.